So Hamas leader Ismail assassinated in Tehran after attending the inauguration of Iran's new president. Iran Hamas announced no one immediately claimed responsibility, but suspicion fell on Israel, which has vowed to kill Hani and other Hamas leaders over the October 7th attack on Israel that killed 1,200 people and took 250 hostages. Hamas blamed Israel for the killing, with Iran vowing a harsh and painful response. Israel carried out a rare strike on Beirut, killing top Hezbollah commander Fawaz Shukr, no relation to Tupac. Israel right. Defense Minister Yoav Gallant warned that Israel could take Lebanon back to the Stone Age, but stated, "We don't want to do it." Cross-border attacks between Israel and Lebanon have intensified since the Hamas-led attack on Israel. The assassination on Hania and Shakur could lead to significant regional escalation, with intentional leaders calling for de-escalation to prevent a broader conflict. Adam.
Man, this week officially, you have to ask yourself, are we now closer to a regional war or further away from a regional war? I'll let you guys answer that. I would say that these killings of leaders, as appropriate as they may be, has brought the region, I use that word specifically, the region closest to a regional war that we've been since October 7th. So let me give you a little context here. Who are they killing? So after October 7th, Benjamin Netanyahu and Israeli leadership vowed to do one thing. What was that one thing? They're going to eliminate every single person that helped plan and coordinate October 7th. The only thing that you need to think about is October 7th to Israel is our 9/11. Just digest that for a second. So they went after this guy, Ismail Haniyeh. Now, who is he? He is the political leader of Hamas. So they also killed, they killed three people this month, major, major people. By the way, they killed him. Do you know where they killed this guy? In Tehran.
Yeah, that's
not right. In Gaza, not in the West Bank. He was in Tehran. So there's a message there, what I'll tell you in a second. They also killed the Hezbollah military commander, your boy Tupac, was Shakur, Fuad Shakur. They killed him in Beirut, so the capital of Lebanon, Beirut, the capital of Iran, Tehran. And they also killed, this is another thing that just came out in the Wall Street Journal, the Hamas top military leader, which his name is Mohammed Daif. Now, there's another guy called Yahya Sinwar that they still need to go after. By the way, all these guys, they're on the U.S. terror watch list. Like, these aren't good dudes. Say what you will. So there's builders, and then there's destroyers. These guys don't build anything. Their goal is to destroy. And who are they looking to destroy? They're looking to destroy Israel. They're looking to destroy America. They're looking to destroy American values. So Ismail Haniyeh, now this is something that you'll probably resonate with you. Where did this guy become famous? Have you ever heard his name before?
Which guy?
Ismail Haniyeh. You can show his face.
The Ismail guy? I still don't even remember.
Just show his face. So I want to get your opinion on this, and then I'm...
Okay.
Ismail Haniyeh, this guy right here, why did he
become
famous?
Was he in Borat?
He was not in Borat, yeah. bombastic, threatening, saying wild things. He's been the face of Hamas for decades.
Okay.
The political face.
And now, this picture is the before the assassination, right?
Thank yeah, for you, sure. Tom. The comedy act coming soon. So do you remember in 1983... You probably don't remember this. There was a bombing of a U.S. base in Beirut, Lebanon.
I remember, but I wasn't.
Do you remember
I was
this?
Too young.
Of
yeah,
course.
Yeah, over 200 soldiers died. It was a barracks, and yeah.
Correct. Thank you, Tom. So he planned that. Mm-hmm. That was him. So you know how they say forgive, don't forget? They didn't forgive or forget this guy. And really? You know who didn't forget? The U.S. as well. Mm-hmm. He killed 200 American soldier. Service people.
Yep.
So this is who this guy is. So you ask the question, like, why is Israel so aligned with America? Because this is what who they're going after right here. So this is the message that Israel and the Mossad and Netanyahu, by the way, did you see the video that Netanyahu did after this killing? I can send it to you in a second. Basically, he's like, I'm James Bond, is what he said. Here's the message that they're sending to the Hamas leadership and these Iranian proxies. You ready? Whether it's Hezbollah, yeah, this right here. Whether it's Hezbollah, whether it's Hamas, whether the Houthis. We're gonna find you and we're gonna get you no matter where you are. You can be in the capital of Tehran, we're gonna get you. You could be in the capital of Lebanon, we're gonna get you. And that is their goal. They stated that goal. They're going to go after every single planner that planned October 7th, and they're doing that.
But you know what sucks, though? Every single one of those people that you named that died, the very next hour, somebody else stepped up and took their spot. Like, it's not like that vacancy stays open. And I get it, Adam. Good for them. They deserve to die, and let God judge them, and that's going to be their calling. But you know what? The moment these guys went, the number two guy just became the number one guy. And that cycle will never stop, and it will keep going. And it's a sad thing, but it's reality.
Great point. And this is the constant game of whack-a-mole that you're playing. Yeah. But the question is, are you just going to not? Like, so that's like saying, hey, I use the 9/11 analogy. We got to go get Bin Laden. So what are we going to say? No, don't go get Bin Laden, because once we kill him, there's going to be someone else pops up.
No, I'm just being realistic.
What message does that send that you don't kill the attackers of 9/11?
No, I'm saying kill him. No, you're mistaking my point. My point is, it just sucks. We killed. Congratulations. We're happy for the moment. That does not stop. That terrorist organization, those cells, they just next guy up.
But that's, you kill Trump, someone else is going to fill it. That's life.
Yeah.
Someone's going to fill that vacuum. But they're not playing. Is this the Netanyahu video? Where he compares himself to James Bond. Go ahead.
Netanyahu.
So,
what did he say?
He basically, instead of saying Bond, James Bond, he's saying Netanyahu.
Yeah.
Bibi Netanyahu. Look, that's marketing, whether you agree with it or not. That's kind of where he's going. By the way, his approval ratings in Israel, 32%, but now they've gone up a little bit since they've gone after this. But it's not like he's beloved at this point.
Yeah.
You know, I made the analogy that he's the Trump of Israel. He has his base, his 30, 35%, 40% base. I don't know if he's going to win the next election, if there is one. But this is the reality of what's going on in the Middle East right now.
Vinny.
No, I'm just like, my point just being that, I mean, good. Who isn't happy when terrorists are murdered, especially innocent lives that mm-hmm. were called, and fellow servicemen. But I think, dude, that idea, that terrorism, that war on terror, it'll never stop. There's no face.
Of course.
It just keeps, and
it's
sucks.
It's like the war on drugs.
Yeah, exactly.
It's never going to stop.
It's going to keep going, and it's just horrible.
If you sit back and say, you know, this reminds me, I can't get around fatalistic and concessionary thinking. It's like saying, just let your kids have, you know, drink, party, have sex, do whatever they want to do in college because they're going to do it anyway. No, you got to stand up and show some leadership at times. And it's painful. And the sausage making of international leadership when people are bloodthirsty.
What?
The correlation between the two with the sausage making. But you're
unbelievable, Tom.
No, and international diplomacy, international foreign policy, and responding to really bad people is an ugly, gruesome thing. But if nobody stands up to show the leadership to do something about it, which includes brokering peace, protecting the innocent, and being really tough on those that are the bad actors, it's not easy, it's not beautiful to look at, but it's got to be done.
I think the real question here is Iran going to do anything to Israel? That's the real question that we're not talking about.
Well, right. What did they do last time? They launched 50 rockets that landed out in the cornfields.
Yeah. So is Iran going to do anything to Israel? Because if you really think about it, Iran's retaliation so far, when they give threats, their score on threats isn't that high. Okay, when they say they're going to do something, it's not a very high threat of we're going to come after you and do X, Y, Z. Now, could this be a different one? Possibly. Are they going to come out and do anything major? Possibly. Will they be successful? Possibly. But based on the last 8 years, they're going to send 50, 100, 200 rockets. They're going to, try to blow something up. And then they're going to say, we seek our vengeance. And they're going to play that clip for their people and move on. Mm-hmm. And everybody moves on. Qassem Soleimani, this one. And then it's going to be similar thing that
bunch of rabbits in a cornfield die.
That's, and by the way, you know, this guy was a former prime minister of Palestine. This guy wasn't a lightweight.
Ishmael Haniyeh.
Yeah, he was a former.
He was the face of political
Was it a bombing? Yeah. Was it an assassination?
They got him in Tehran. But can I respond to what you're saying? You're absolutely right, PBD, because whether it's Hezbollah, whether it's the Houthis, whether it's Hamas, these are all just Iranian proxies. So Iran is going to respond one way or another. is it going to be exactly what you said, this sort of faux missile attack that they did the last time in earlier this summer, or are they going to use one of their proxies to attack? But Vinny, let me give you a little perspective, and this is something, because you're a Christian, and this is where my mind went when all this was happening, because now you're bringing Lebanon in. Now, Lebanon, other than Egypt, is the most, percentage-wise, it's the most Christian country in the Middle East.
I know a bunch
so I'm going to give you some quotes out here from our friend Hanai, and then you can maybe respond to this, because he said, "We promise you that we will not cede any single part of Palestine. We will not cede Jerusalem. We will continue to fight, and we will not lay down our arms. This is the whole from the river to the sea. Palestine will be free," which is AKA, we're going to kill all the Jews. So, but here's their methodology, and this is where I want to bring the Christian. "We come to say that the Quran is our constitution. We are committed to God and his holy book, Allah. Allah willing, they should try to carry out their crime against the Quran. Allah will tear the state apart, and it will become Allah's lesson to anyone who tries to desecrate the holy book. There's no man-made laws that they're abiding by." Mm-hmm. This is a mandate from Allah. So I believe them. You know, Pat wrote the book, Choose Your Enemies Wisely. I respect the enemy because I absolutely believe that they actually want to become, take over Jerusalem, take over Israel from the Palestine to this, for the sea to be free. So here's my question to Christians out there. Do you know what percentage of the Middle East was Christian at the turn of the century in 1900? What percentage of the Middle East was Christian around 1900, turn of the century? Take a guess. Take a guess.
40?
40%? What do you got, Tom? Don't show it, Rob.
30?
Turn of the century.
1900.
French Foreign Legion and everything that was over there. It was French Lebanon. I'm going to go 70.
Okay. 70% of the Middle East?
No. Are you talking... Wait.
I'm saying Middle East.
What are you talking about? You're talking
about... I'm saying you know what the Middle East is, and you know what Christianity is. What percentage of the Middle East was Christian?
No. I'll go really low. If you're talking about the land that became the Israel state...
No, just Middle East, Tom.
Middle East in general, 5%.
Okay. PBD?
Less than 10 points.
You're actually pretty accurate. 13% in 1900 was Christian population in the Middle East. What is it here? 12.7. Yeah, way off. So then you got to ask yourself, where was it at the turn of the 21st century, around 2010? I won't have 5%. So every 100 years, you're losing half the population. There it is, less than 5%. So by the way, by 2050, by the time that you know you have kids that are grown up, Christians will be 1-2% of the Middle East. By the way, where was Jesus from?
Jerusalem.
Nazareth, right?
Nazarene.
Middle East. Christianity started in the Middle East. So you're looking at countries like Egypt, like Lebanon, like Syria, like Iraq, like Iran, that had vast Christian populations. C'est la vie. So if you want to be a Christian in the Middle East, good luck going to visit any of your churches, of your holy areas under certain leadership. By the way, here's a fun fact for you. Egypt, 10 to 15 million current Christians. That's number one. Percentage-wise, Lebanon has the most Christians. But then you go down the list, and you have countries like Iran, Iraq, Jordan, Turkey, Palestine, Qatar, Saudi Arabia. On this list right here, I can show you. Pat, how many Christians are in Saudi Arabia, the UAE, Yemen, any of the bottom? That's not percentage, by the way.
Less than 10?
10. Basically saying, most Arab countries, dude, don't be Christian. Oh, here it is right here. Iran, Turkey. Like, so as a Christian, you have to look at what's going on in the Middle East and be like, bruh, what's happening here? So remember I bought you that a gift from the Armenian quarter? In Jerusalem, the beautiful thing about Jerusalem, which Ismail Haniyeh Hamas basically says we want to take over, they want to take over all of it. The beautiful thing about Jerusalem, you know, it's cut into four quarters. Did you know this?
Yes.
The Kotel is what it's called. There's the Jewish quarter. There's the Christian quarter. There's the Armenian quarter. And there's the Muslim quarter. Equal access to any single quarter you want. That's the beautiful thing of Jerusalem. Here it is right here, the four quarters. If someone like Hamas or someone like in that elk takes over Jerusalem, there's no quarters. There's one hole. And it's under Hamas rule. So for Christians out there, just understand that this is the whole conversation of why, oh my God, these Christians, evangelical Christians are so supportive of Israel, because I think they recognize if they ever want to go visit places in the Middle East or go see where Jesus was born, they're going to have to go through Israel for that, not Hamas. That's my point.
Well, we'll see. I mean, this conflict has been going for how long now? You got 9 months. Is that what is that?
No, it's gonna be. It's gonna be. Ten months.
Nine
it's
months.
Gonna be October 7th. Is gonna be a year.
We announced the different speakers that'll be at the Vol Conference. Dwayne the Rock Johnson, which you already know. Nick Saban, greatest college football coach of all time. If you say no, it's because you probably don't like the guy, but the guy's won, I think, 7 national championships. This will be one of the first business conferences he's doing since he retired. Max Tegmark, who wrote a book called Life 3.0, some claim it's the best book of all time on AI. Even Elon Musk is a big fan of his. And then Will Guidara, who founded the number one restaurant in the world, Vault Conference. We have CEO tickets sold out, founder tickets sold out, executive tickets sold out. Platinum's about to sell out. Only generals are going to be left. And then the Manek, those of you guys that are competing for Manek, I cannot wait for you to come to the Manek dinner, the Manek lounge. There's going to be a room where you'll be networking with other people, CEOs. Here's what the categories look like right now with lightweight. Bryce Mitchell's at the top, then Caleb, then Jose competing. Rob, can you just go to the site so we can see some of the other names? Just go to Manek and then go to the leaders board, and we can show that. Zoom in a little bit if you could. So the way it works is scoring system. Per Manek you finish, go to the top, Rob, a little bit. Not that high. Go a little lower, Rob. Go a little lower, right in the middle right there. For each completed Manek is 1 point. Each review is 2 points. Each unique review is 3 points that you get. So based on that scoring system, you can go a little lower. Here's what you'll notice. Bryce Mitchell at the top, then Caleb, Jose. These are people that have never been an expert on Manek, that never had done a Manek, that just started. Adam Hudson, Breanne Dressen, Stephen Hamal, all these guys. You're in the top 10. Go to the next one, middleweight. These are people that had done Manek before. Matten's first place right now. Big lead, 211. Then it's Samuel Riley, Drew Miller. Cecilia Vargas is on there. And CEO Rolo Tomasi. Okay, he's at sixth place.
Rolo.
Now go to the next one.
Welcome
heavyweight.
Back, Rolo.
We got Dennis Ponev, first place. Then it's Candace. Then it's Calvin Ng. Dustin's right behind Calvin. Rob Gargullo. Oh, Rob G, buddy boy. Wayne Wyant, Michael Mara, Sapala, Kelly Davis. Super heavyweight. Vinny dominating everybody. And then let's go to the next one. Go to the next one. These are users asking questions. Matt's at the top, but only a 10-point lead. And I think he's coming from Australia to the vault.
Mark.
Russell Morgan.
Mark.
Mark. And then Russell Morgan, Rachel Ronald. You know who you are. And then go to the next one. These are people that have never used Manek. Now they're asking questions. Shaw, Rachel Cox, Matthew, User Zero, Chris. So these are folks that are using Manek. Gang, in a political climate like this, you guys are asking a lot of questions about politics. Download the app. Ask Candace. She responds like this. Ask Tulsi. They're actually responding. Ask Cuomo. They're actually responding. What do you think about XYZ? Some of the biggest communications right now are being done on Manek. Go back to that profile you had, Rob, of all those guys. Questions for me, for Tom, for Vinny, for Adam. Use our QR code. Ask us whatever questions you got today. So if you like this clip and you want to watch another one, click right here. And if you want to watch the entire podcast, click right here.